So soil nesting bees are difficult to manage because it's hard to create a soil type that soil nesting bees like. There's a lot of different types of soil nesting bees that are important in our area. And so maybe they like different types of soil, but the best way to manage those is to protect those sites when you see them. Cavity nesting bees are the honeybees and the bumblebees. Bumblebees will nest in cavities. They can be in the ground, or they can be like a old bird's nest or a rat's nest. They can actually even be in just real thick leaves and things. So like areas like this ditch down here might have habitat for bumblebees, or back in the woods. Probably not so much in the middle of the field unless it's like a rodent burrow that has been abandoned. But stick nesting bees, you'll see in your publication ways to encourage habitat for them. And we've put a lot of these structures out in different places, 10 of them. And we found like in our area, more of a limited use of those. In some areas, bees would use these, in other areas not. This particular one we removed from a place where they weren't using them. But in other places, they are using them. And how you know if they use them is what these are. It's just a straight hole through there. And the bees go in and lay an egg, provision it with nectar and pollen, and then seal it with either mud or leaves. And that'll be back here. And then they'll keep going until they fill out the hole. And then they'll cover over the end, and you'll see the plug there. And so in some parts of the country, this is a good way to get habitat started and get pollination going. But here, I would say that if you just put them out, it would be more of a, it would provide habitat and probably increase some bees, but it might be more of an interesting thing you might want to do. There are people in the area that do orchards and do stock stick nests with bees that they purchase and get shipped in from somewhere else. And they often will use more of a cardboard tube. This is the right size for the osmia bees. They're managed for fruit tree pollination because they come out very early, and they don't go through a long period of time in the spring. They pretty much lay their eggs and they're done by the time the fruit trees are done. So that's another option to keep bees for pollination. And I have heard of people getting these started in our area, and then they're not having to buy more. They just keep their population going, because they have found that, you know, when you bring in bees like these from different parts of the country, they're not going to emerge at the right time for our weather. But, you know, over time, you'll end up with a population that will. These tubes, cardboard, you want to put in some kind of protection from the weather, like a tin can is good. They do better in shady areas. Some of the ones that we had out in the bright sun would have some use, but not a lot. But probably the structure that did the best was in the woods. And you know, there's probably, it was more of a forest edge just like this. And there's probably already a lot of habitat there for them. So maybe I put them in, you know, beside another place. One guy sent us a bunch of pictures of some stick nesting bees in a pile of firewood. There was a lot of holes in the firewood where they were already nesting a lot. So he put some of these blocks around the firewood to get them to move in. In the first year, they didn't move in. They were already in the firewood and they didn't move into these. So that can be another effect of, you know, of maybe not seeing a lot of usage, isn't that those bees aren't here, but that they are already using something somewhere else. You do have to, these have their own diseases that you have to take care of. So this cardboard is good because after, you can just use them 1 year at a time, throw them away after they emerge. And then that way a fungal disease doesn't build up in these. Whereas the wood, you actually have to sterilize these and bleach to reuse them. Over time, they'll get chalk root.
Did you buy that construction?
No, we made this with a router. There's different sizes here. This is the size for the commercially available osmia bees. This size is we had a giant resin bee nest in these. It's the megachilid. It's the same family as those smaller bees, but they're much larger and will use this larger hole. Some of these smallest sticks, some parasitic wasps will use those. And then these other two sizes are more for the smaller osmia types, but we just got a router bit with a curve on one end, so it's actually flat on another end, and just routed those boards out and then cut them up, stacked them up. There's a bit of cellophane type material and a piece of fabric in between. And the only reason we've done that is so that we can take them apart and look through the cellophane at what's in there without damaging them. You don't have to do that to make one of these. And I think the router probably would be easier than drilling holes, because we did some of that too and it takes forever. But this is a lot of holes right there. Yes, yeah, some of them nest the same way, parasitic wasps, and then others, I guess predatory wasps, I should say. Parasitic wasps more reproduce inside the larvae of the, like a caterpillar, so I should probably say predatory. Yes, definitely. And that's important in honeybees as well as the treated wood. You can buy beehives out of treated wood, but one of our cooperators is doing some studies putting treated wood in beehives and measuring the impact of that, and the chemical does get all through there, and it does affect the health of the hive. So we want to use untreated wood.
You also want to keep those up off the ground, right?
These are probably okay about that high off the ground. We've had them on these posts, but with all the rain and stuff we get, a lot of them ended up just, the weight pulled them forward, or this material just kind of fell apart and pulled through and they kind of dumped out. So we moved a couple to the ground like this, and there's bees active in them. So I think that would be okay. You are gonna get more moisture this way, I would think, than if they were up high, but it should be okay.
And the chicken wires to prevent the...
Oh yeah. The raccoons and woodpeckers, birds, just anything getting in there. Birds can eat those bees out. You have to, there's our parasitic wasps that feed on these bees, and you need to protect the larvae, and that's through the wood and through like more of a better tape in the back to close this up. And it's the cardboard, they can't oviposit through these, the parasitic wasps. They can go, if you got like a thinner tube, they can actually get through the paper and lay their eggs inside here. But they can also go in through the front. So if you're managing these bees for pollination of fruit trees and keeping the osmia bees, then one of the things you can do is, after they've sealed up their cells, is remove those and bring them to a protected place inside under your house. There's different ways you can protect them. Put a UV light with a pan of water away from them that attracts the parasitic wasps and they drown in there, or you can just seal them up in some more protection. So any more questions on native bee nesting native bees? Because I've got some things to talk about with honeybees too. A lot of my work the last 2 years dealt with native bee pollination in the field and looking at what types of native bees are important in our area. And there's, you know, I could go on with that for a while, but what I'm doing this year is we're getting into queen rearing and honeybee breeding, trying to breed bees that are resistant to mites and diseases. And there's a lot of work going into this right now, and it's pretty much more or less the main focus of howling to deal with varroa mites. Because for all this time, as Dr. Skinner was saying, that we've been using pesticides to deal with these, and it's coming to the conclusion that it's going to be better to just breed resistance into the honeybees, and that's some really successful programs doing that in Baton Rouge with the Varroa sensitive hygienic is the name of the bee, and then there's also like Minnesota hygienic. These are breeding programs that are developing hygienic traits into the honeybees to where they remove larvae that are infected with parasites, and the parasites reproduce in those larvae, so the honeybees remove those and they can't reproduce, or they reproduce in fewer numbers. They also will remove larvae infected with bacterial diseases, so that reduces the number of spores that those bacterial diseases are producing in the hive. Pretty much the honeybee stocks that we have in our area, for the most part, are heavily influenced by honeybee stocks in Georgia and California and other states where there's large queen-rearing operations. Because, for example, if someone in our area is selling honeybees or anywhere or just wants bees, we oftentimes get queens from states, these large commercial queen-rearing, so that it makes it easier to make splits and divides and get honeybee colonies to people. And these large operations have been managing their bees with pesticides, and therefore they do not have their resistant stocks. Part of the work that Marta Spivak in Minnesota is doing is consulting with these large operators and getting them to start adopting breeding practices to get these hygienic traits into their commercial stocks, so that as they are distributing these bees across the U.S., those traits come with those bees. But another strategy is to kind of promote small-scale bee breeding operations and queen rearing. It's a pretty good opportunity for beekeepers to generate income selling the queens, and they can more easily spend the time that it takes to select for those traits. But there's a lot of time is really the reason that we rely on these large operations, and there's a series of steps into rearing queens. It's not just one thing, and I can kind of go over the steps just so you get an idea of the scale it would take. So say you want to sell 1,000 queens, which isn't too enormous amount. That would be a good goal of a small bee breeder to sell 1,000 queens, because that's about, you can probably get $30 a queen if it's selected for hygienic behavior. People are looking for that trait. And you would start by setting up an area where you can do it, and we're starting to do that here. We don't have enough colonies out here yet, but we have some colonies here in front of the woods here in the sun. They do better in the sun. And we have a bunch of these, or we don't have a bunch of these yet, but we're putting, these here are nukes. This is a small colony. And this is going to be important in queen rearing. So I'm just trying to get you a little setup here. Okay, you got to set up the bee yards in this way where you have space. These are better in the shade. They don't overheat. And then you have to set up a honeybee colonies that will raise queens. And honeybee colonies will do this on their own. And it's easy to make additional colonies from one colony. You can actually just take half the colony of a strong colony and move it over here, make sure there's eggs in both colonies, and the colony that didn't get the queen will raise a new queen. But this is an expensive way to make one queen. You just took one colony and made one additional queen. You could probably split a really strong colony 4 or 5 times that way. We did that a couple of weeks ago. There was a colony that was really strong and it was going to swarm and leave and make a new colony in the woods anyway, so we split it 4 or 5 times. But it's still an expensive way to make a lot of queens. So the way that you make a lot of queens is you get one of these very strong colonies and reduce it down in size to where they're crowded, where there's lots of bees in there, and you remove the brood so that the brood that you put in there for them to raise queens out of, they give it a lot of attention. You leave some brood in there, but the majority of it you remove. And then, after you've done selection, after you've decided what queens you want to raise your new queens from, after measuring the amount of mites, looking for diseases, how productive they were. And that's the whole, you know, you've done that for the entire last year, is figuring out which stock you want to propagate from. And then you manage those breeders in a way, those colonies in a way where you have the right age larvae to transfer into these little cups. So all it takes to get queens that you want and get a bunch of them is to take a little small tool and remove a bee larvae that has just hatched from its egg from a cell, and you put it into these cups. And then you need magnifying tools, and lighting helps. And then you get, you know, a bunch of these, this isn't very many, and you put them in a frame and you hang them upside down in there. And oftentimes, you know, typically your larvae are pointing out this way in the comb, but they will raise their queens vertically oriented. So you put them like this and put them down in the center of that heavily populated colony, and they'll naturally start raising queens. And this is kind of the cells that they start building and feeding those out. And then when those are sealed, you can take these out and remove them, and you end up putting each one of these in a small colony. And you need, for every queen that you raise, you need another one of these. And this is actually a pretty large box for a mating nuke, what we're going to call a mating nuke. Often in the larger commercial operations, they use a box that's only like this, and they put one cup of bees in that box, and then one of these queen cells. And that's enough bees to keep that queen fed while she goes out and mates, and within 2 weeks she'll start laying in that small box. But we're kind of going more with these bigger boxes. We think that for small producers this might be better, because you can, once you set these up one time, they should kind of keep through more of the season. Those small ones you have to keep resetting up, but if you let a queen, once she mates, let her lay in there a little while, that'll keep the population of the bees in there. And then a lot of people sell nukes in our area, and so they're already making these up anyway, these size colonies up, and they're ready to go with a queen, or they can take that queen out and put a new one in. You don't have to fill it full of bees to mate a queen either, so you can, it's at more of a dual purpose box, and it fits the same size frames that are in these hives. So the small boxes fit a different size frame. Some people use the same size frame, but more than just two frames. And so then you need to take all these out and put them in your mating yard, which is what this is going to be. We right now we're mating our queens in a different location that isn't as desirable, and we're setting this up exactly how we want it. And so we'll have a bunch of these back through there, and the colonies out here are going to be what the queens hopefully will mate with, the males from these colonies. And to get males, you have to put drone comb in there. It's a comb that's larger in size, so you have to manage those differently as well to make sure they raise lots of males. And you want to put, you know, your best colonies here too, so they'll mate. But really, in a more of an ideal breeding program, you use instrumental insemination so that you know exactly what you're selecting for, and you can, that's what they'd use to develop, you know, highly hygienic bees. But some of those highly hygienic bees aren't that productive because they're so hygienic and remove so much brood that it impacts the population growth of the colony. So they actually do better mated with something else. So you can get those breeder queens from that are instrumentally inseminated, and then open mate them here, and you end up with a hygienic bee that's also productive.
And you think you're going to have people around here to do all that? I mean,
well, there's people that do.
A viable business for someone like
yeah.
who's got.
Yeah, there's people that sell queens in Tennessee. Yeah, there's a.
You don't need, it sounds like you need a PhD in all kinds of.
No, you don't. People that, if you keep bees for a long, honeybees for a long time, the concepts that sound complicated, they're not really. There's, you know, I know a lot of beekeepers that have never went to college, and they're some of the best beekeepers I've know, and they're the people, you know, I learned a lot from them. So it's not as, it's strange. It's insects rearing is what it is. It's not something where, but after, you know, we've got beekeepers, you know, 10, 20, 30 years, they've been doing this kind of thing, and it's not that complicated.
So the extension, you know, often consults with farmers about cash crops and gets them sort of set up in that whole thing. Is that one of the goals of this, is that you can set up beekeepers to have this be a cash generating thing more than just selling honey?
Yes. Yeah. We're kind of getting into this through the CAP grant that the John talked about earlier with the addressing colony collapse disorder. There's 7 or 8, I think, states that are doing similar things just within that grant program of encouraging people in their area to get into queen rearing. And we kind of came in on the tail end of the that objective in the whole thing. But since it's an extension objective and we're already doing a lot of extension with the website, we kind of got into that too. And so we're going to be doing more of that in the coming years, next year.
So can you start a box that size with a cup of bees?
No, you need two. I've been putting 2 frames of brood, cat brood, with covered with bees, and then shaking a few more bees and then putting empty comb in there so that I get a pretty good start, and then the queen has somewhere to lay when she's made it.
All right, beekeeping. Well, bees can do what? They can sting. So we want to be protected in case there is a problem. So we wear a suit. At least I do. You can wear a veil. I would suggest you wear a veil if that's the only thing you're going to wear, and against bees. And it's a good idea to have, because if a bee stings you in the eye, you lose your sight. I don't think anybody's ready to do that. So if I'm going to take anybody to a bee yard that I have anything to do with for a demonstration or anything else, they have to wear a veil. They can wear a pair of shorts and a t-shirt if that's what they want, but they're going to wear a veil. So protection is important, and if you're starting in bees, it's a good idea to go fully protected, simply because you don't need to have a bad experience to turn you off from a really neat hobby and or moneymaker. And so all this stuff basically zips together, which I like because it's bee tight. Other times are folding veils and whatnot that you have to string tight, and hopefully that you're hoping the bees don't find a way in. Because if they find a way in, you're liable to be stung. And you won't be stung on the head, because that's much more delicate area. It hurts a whole lot more too. So this type of unit just fits like this. And I get a lot of visibility, it's green. It's ventilated all the way around instead of having a bunch of cloth in it. And that's nice when it's hot and you're in this hot bee suit. So this is what we used to keep bees in, and around the world, in different parts of the world, they'll make hives out of mud, straw, anything really product they can do that would make a container to support bees. This has a few holes in it, but the disadvantage of this is what the bees do with this comb. They usually put sticks in there, crossing sticks or something, and the bees build their comb, but they build it every which way. Comb's a valuable commodity. So in order to harvest anything, they'd have to take a curved knife and scrape everything out, and then maybe hand squeeze it through cloth to get the honey out. Okay, and what are the bees doing in all this process? I don't know, maybe they have to kill the bees to do that with them. So even though I like this, it's romantic and whatever, a nice English type garden thing to put in your garden and look pretty, I wouldn't put bees in one. That's why I show it to you guys as a demo. But I'd rather have the movable frame hive, which is what we have here, named after Langstroth, who is a preacher that found out that if you put your frames between 3/8 and 5/16 of an inch apart, the bees won't gum it up with glue and they won't build extra comb in it. So they will keep this bee space. And that's how we got to be able to use the movable frame hive, which, you know, it hasn't changed a whole lot since then. There's been a lot of different ways of suggestions of how many frames, their orientation to the entrance, and all kinds of other things, but this is the kind of the classic approach we're using here. Now, the sizes of the boxes can vary by height. All the other dimensions are the same, but the height of the boxes and the frames have to be the same inside. And We use all mediums because I discovered one reason is because when I started getting older, my back got older. And these things are really heavy. And you get a heavy full super, the big deep ones, which are like this, and you have 80 pounds of honey in it. It's an awkward pickup. You got finger holds like this, and you swear it's 250 pounds, And for those, I'd rather have somebody basically with me. I mean, yeah, I did it as a youngster because that's the only thing they had, but I prefer not to. So I go with mediums. And the brood chamber is the area where they're making more bees, and two deeps or three of the mediums are about the same area to get the bees to make more bees. You constantly want them making more bees. They have from anywhere between 20, 30, 40, 50, 60, 70, 80, 90,000 bees in a colony, and some maybe more. And you'll see, by some size, you can get an idea, well, maybe that colony right there is much better than this one. It's bigger. Well, actually it is. That has quite a few bees in it. And it also has two boxes we've added on top that we call supers, where the intention is for the bees to put honey there. Okay, brood below, honey above. Huh? I got bored with white, and I decided that I just got out of the whole idea, and so I basically had a lady working for me, and I let her go, and she did some wild things, like that box right there, planting sunflowers on it and everything else, which is not really what I had intended for her to do, but I got it, so hey, it's really, I'd rather do that. If you go to the Purdue University yards, they're painted like you see hives in Mexico, all kinds of colors. And to me, that's much more festive. So that's just my own personal thing. But I would not paint real dark colors. I wouldn't want, even though that blue is probably a little darker, I wouldn't have a whole colony painted dark blue, because then it would tend to absorb more heat. You want the heat reflected away so that you don't build up the heat, because then the bees, if they get too hot inside, they have to spend too much time collecting water, and they're not gathering nectar or pollen. So they're working to be the original air conditioners, which you stand on the side of a bee colony and put your finger down their entrance in a hot day, you'll feel airflow coming out. It's pretty cool. They fan, they move their wings, they create this airflow in the bee space inside the colony, and it cools them. But they have to go to get water. So you need a water source nearby, your ideal apiary, you need food source nearby. Ideal is afternoon shade and morning sun. We chose this location due to the woods and the way we want to do the mating yard. So it's not so much for the exposure, but proximity, and it's level. All these factors you figure out, well, I want to do bees, where can I put them? Well, don't put them on the side of a hill where they might cause a problem. Put them to an area where you can get to them, where they have the sources of water and food supply nearby. If you plant them in an area, or you put them in an area where there's no food, they're not going to do very well. The organic farm really needs bees for this kind of operation, so this is a good place to have them for this, and we'll continue to do that. In the future, when you come out here, you may see some interesting plantings of wildflowers, because we're going to try to, something I want to do for a long time, this time I'm going to go for it, whether we get the grant money or not. And we're going to plant sections of just swaths where we're going to try to do it reasonable, like disc a couple sections of ground. We have to till it some to sow the seed, and then hopefully let Mother Nature and the seed take over and let this thing grow up to where you've got a display of wildflowers that will also provide food for bees. So there'll be a couple sections along that, between the fence and the railroad track back there. One over here, probably one down in this, well, maybe not one over there then. One down in this lower area where you see the shrubs and whatnot below us, it's kind of wet. Put one along the side of that. There's a couple over there areas, one with clover and one that's kind of poor soil. We want to see, well, how are they doing poor soil? I don't know, so let's find out. Maybe certain things will come up and other things won't, because you got like, what, 25 or so seed, different kinds of seeds in each set of wildflowers. So we know, due to past experience here with some of this and this kind of seed, that some things will come up real nice, maybe do fine for 1 year and fizzle out the next, but other things will come on. So we're going to see how it works. And it should look pretty anyway, in spite of the fact, if it does anything else. Now what I'm going to do now is just light a smoker. There's the plastic bag. I got matches. Plastic bag with needles right back there. right there. Thanks. What a smoker is simply a device to calm the bees. You light a fire in what's basically a tin can. This one's kind of designed, it has a basket around so you can't burn yourself. It's easy. And it has a spout so you can direct the smoke. And usually the wind won't blow until I start lighting the smoker, right? Well, Murphy, he was a beekeeper too, didn't you know that? And he will do that. And I like long needle pines, which we got some out in the other experiment station, so I like to use those. Okay, Murphy. I'm gonna have to get back my Boy Scout badge if I use too many more matches.
I didn't think you were allowed to use matches in Boy Scout.
What? Flamethrowers?
Yeah.
Well, you can do it that way too. Or you can use also things like batteries and steel wool. Yeah, it's a little bit windy. Also, these pine needles were a little bit damp.
Yeah.
We gathered them on, let's see, when was that day of that rain? We gathered them before it rained, but we got soaked moving these bees out here. That was fun moving bees in the rain. I hadn't had that experience for a while. I don't want to repeat it anytime soon. Say Murphy was a beekeeper. Now when I need that thing, it'll probably be out, but I'm gonna go to get it going pretty good to start. And what smoke does is it's a combination that confuses them, and in the process it calms them. They become a bit disoriented. And what I do have as well, if I need them, and I'll put them on, is I have gloves, but I don't like using gloves unless I have to. I have these hive tools. This is kind of the old-fashioned type tool. It looked like a little pry bar. That was my original one, and I got in 79. And these other ones are frame lifters, which I like better because you use leverage to remove the first frame of the box. And I love this frame lifter kind of thing. And after a while, you just forget. I forget I've got anything in my hands at all. You just get used to it. So it's whatever works for you. That's to each his own. Now what you can do, let's see, I think probably standing on this side is probably best because you get reflection off the front. So if you'll stand on this other side, I'm going to go in here. We're going to see what these ladies are doing. Mostly ladies, but they're guys too, because what are we doing? We're making drones. There may be poison ivy here too, it's everywhere. Thanks. Hiya, Goyles. How you doing? Now a lot of the bees are in the cage with me. The bees that are in the cage with me are basically flying around because they're disoriented foragers. They're going, man, I'm going out to get something, and I've zoned into the place right over there was where we took them from. If you see, second set of hives, there's a little colony with one box. That's a trap colony. We put that there to take care of the foragers who were coming back and looking for this home that we moved. And so that's what a lot of these bees are flying around up here doing, just to, they're bouncing around on top. There are a few drones up there too. But so what I do is, this is a device we put it as basically to confine them while we moved them. We use screws instead of banging them with a hammer. They don't care for banging a whole lot. And so, and we use a strap like this to strap them up. So I'm gonna undo this strap and take it apart. I'm gonna puff a few puffs in here like this. And our colonies have, you notice there's smoke coming out the bottom because I have open bottom boards. That's a physical tactic against mites. If it screens so that the mites fall off the bees, they fall out of the colony and you get rid of them. It's not using a chemical method. When you move around a beehive, you basically, you're kind of like, think of, you're directing a symphony. You're not being herky-jerk, because if you make sudden motions and movements, the bees don't really respond well to that. Remember, it's a stimulus response. So what I normally do is give a couple puffs of the entrance, then I pull up the top a little, put one puff under here. They've already stuck it down. I just put it on a couple of, 2 or 3 days ago. They'll glue things shut, anything shut that is smaller than 5/16. With, they get tree sap and they make it into a glue, it's called propolis. And you, what you do with a beehive is you work it from the side and the back, not from the front, because you normally have bees coming in and returning. You won't, you don't want to interrupt their path, you just want to observe them. Okay, that's an outer cover. This is an inner. Has a hole in the middle. You can use a hole for this or that. You can put a feeder in it. You could use it to move the bees and put a screen over it. Okay, in this box here, we've just added these two boxes to it. So there's not much activity so far. Certainly not with the top one. So I'm just gonna take it off. Now, they're working in that one already there. They've already, oh my goodness, that's cool. They've already drawn some nice comb out in the next box. And that, we put them out here, when was it, Michael, Thursday? Yeah. They've already got a few frames done.
Oh, I think that one was
already done. That one have some?
The Martin D10, those light ones were new.
Okay. Well, that one I know was new.
That's a drone frame, the D10.
Which one?
The one that says D10 on the right.
Oh, I see. I got you now on top. All right, I'll show them what that is. Well, I like the frame lifter because you can put this baby in here like this and just pull it up. And yes, the bees will come out and see what you're doing. What are you doing messing with my frame? Okay, and what I'll do is I'll just bring this up. It's a frame of basically of nectar that they're making into honey. They haven't capped it over. When they cap it with wax, they've reduced all the water out of it. But what you're looking at right now is this is all nectar, but there's a lot of it. If you look close enough, you could see glistening liquid in it. Mm-hmm. There's some drones on the frame and some workers. If I shook it a little bit, I'd probably get nectar to fall out, but I'm not going to do that.
So the comb is something that you buy.
The comb, what we put in is a foundation strip, and we normally put it in the whole size of the frame. Now, what I'm going to show you here next is one we've added a it either had drone, did this have drone foundation the whole way, Michael?
It had no foundation at all.
Okay, and you just let them build their own.
Yeah. And
so it should be drone. Okay, it's drone. Or a lot of drone. It's kind of like worker on the top.
It did not fall out like that. Oh, it's wired, actually.
They pulled the one place. But what's interesting about this is, you know, these are what the queen has done. I wish you could hold the frame. You could see it easier. We've got, basically, this, she's laid eggs in every one of those cells. See that really pure white comb? This is laid pretty much, not quite wall to wall, but about everything inside my finger to about the same place on the other side. Eggs that have hatched out, they hatch out in every, but drones probably 3-4 days, the egg hatches out into a little larva. And then they go through a series of molts, like a little worm-like stage. And then when they get to right ready to pupate, they spin a cocoon. As they start spinning a cocoon, the workers close the cell and cap it over. So that's what we call cap brood as a beekeeper, the stage where the developing pupa are. And then after another week or so, they hatch out. There's a drone right in the middle of the frame, right here. This kind of a chunky guy with his compound eyes come all the way together. There's another one here and the top of his head and touch. The workers do not. There's an empty space up there. And we think that has to do because they have more omatidae, or little units, in their eyes to be able to successfully mate with a queen. They got to compete with all the other guys, hey, you know. And then so they take off, and they've got, they have comets. They nest about 30 feet off the, mate 30 feet off the ground. They multiple mate, so each queen needs to mate with 15 different drones. And she saves all the sperm in an organ in her body called a spermatheca, and then it's kind of like, well, I imagine like a faucet in a simplistic way. As the egg comes down the oviduct from, she has 150 to 180 ovarioles. Look like kind of sacks of grapes. And my fingers are like each individual cells, and it's like an egg-laying factory. And basically then they come out of that and go into the oviduct, and then she either lets a sperm out or doesn't. And we think it has to do with she can measure the diameter of the opening of the cell. And if they're wide, she holds the sperm back. If they're worker size, she lets it go and becomes a diploid or a female. And a female that can return actually into a queen if it's fed right, like what Michael's doing with some of his queen rearing and raising them like that. That one may have been, this one looks like it's, this is 2 or 3 weeks, but that is pretty, you can tell how new it is because of the, of how clean that comb is and how white. I mean, it's just pearly white. It hasn't had, that's the first brood, or where the places where they're trying to make more bees. As they may have more brood, the comb will darken with age. And you basically just work slowly, carefully. Don't make herky-jerk motions. So the girls won't reward you. They will teach you if you misbehaved. Okay, and this is all, this basically is laid, is all laid with worker eggs. See the difference of the cell diameters, smaller? But they're putting away a lot of nectar on the edge, and they're starting to cap it over with this real pretty capping white wax. And that's honey at that point. And the goal of the beekeepers then to wait until they have all their honeycomb frames full like that, and then they basically, then they basically harvest.
Well, how long does the whole process take then before you can take the honey out?
It varies depending on how abundant the resources are. It's like how good of a honey flow or nectar flow do you have? If it's a lousy year, you may take a long time, and if it's a good year, you can put a super away in 2 days. Super is 10 frames, 50 pounds or more. Yeah, so that's, you know, they can either do it real quick or take a longer time. All right, that's good. Girls are doing well. Just stay where you are. And you can hear, you know, if I bump something a little bit too much, the bees let me know by noise they make too. They tell me, hey fool, you're bonking around in here. Okay, this frame has cap brood on it. That's cap brood. That's basically the pupal stage developing in the middle, that light brown color. Mm-hmm. Around the edges are all immature until the far edge, and then it's nectar. There's a hive beetle running around. That's one of our little beetle denizens.
So to get cap brood on this new, on a new package takes about 2 weeks.
Well, how long does it take from an egg to an adult?
26 days.
For a drone, yes. For a worker?
21.
Yeah. She's good. She took my class. Yeah. Go, girl.
That was a quiz.
Yeah, well, I need a quiz too most of the time. But anyway, that's, you know, that's a good part of what's going on in a beehive. If I find her ladyship, I'll show you her. I think in this one we do. Well, these are Heinz 57. They're Heinz 57, but they would have some traits from carniolan, some from hygienic, would be what is called varroa sensitive hygiene, VSH. One of the VA Setch daughters?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, even the VA Setch are either, it's between carniolan and Italian. It's nothing. It's a big race.
For people that make claims that they have Russian machines that are resistant, is that just not true?
No, that's another. The Baton Rouge Bee Lab started the Russian program first, and now they're doing more of the VSH stuff, or maybe equally, I don't know, but the Russians are from an area, bees from an area of Russia where they've been in contact with mice for much longer time. And the idea was that they had more of a but the VSH ones they've shown are on board. They're harder to find. Sort of. Not quite yet. I've got a breeder queen and I'm raising some.
There are a lot of bees in this box. Well, I like the big smoker. I like a big. I like the cage and I like a big smoker. Yeah. Big one's a whole lot easier to keep lit. Yeah. Little ones look cute and be fine if you're working one or two colonies, but when you need smoke, you want smoke. I don't like to use a whole lot of smoke, especially when I'm looking for a queen. Just a little bit, because smoke induces the bees to run around and move too much. And you want to look for eggs, because then you know she's been in that area, so you can get an idea and find her that way. I'll go this side of this one. That one hadn't been out of there in a while. They really glued this one in. And that makes it a more challenge, because then you don't want to pop it too bad. But so I've got bridge comb on that this frame. I'm gonna take this one out, even though I don't think it's got anything on it. See how they've glued that thing in there? It's all bee glue. The outside frames of the brood nest often just have honey in them. Sometimes, though, you'll get a prolific queen and she'll be laying all over the whole place.
How often do you replace the wax in those things?
Oh, once every 3 years I'd like to recycle frames because I'd rather see the wax come, you know, be reused. And this one is a new frame. You saw the other one, they'd drawn all the way down. This one hasn't been started yet. This is what it looked like when he put that other white frame that I took out of up here.
But normally we put foundation.
Yeah, that doesn't have foundation.
No, we're inducing them because if they don't have foundation, they'll make drone comb in there. Okay. Or you can get special drone foundation. I'm sorry, girl, I did give you a little tweak, didn't I? Yeah, well, don't do that. That little tweaking. Boy, these ladies are propolizers, Michael. Mm-hmm. You hadn't worked this colony in a while. You just wanted me to get into here, didn't you?
They do not like it.
But then the bees just fill up.
You got the one
the
out
there,
you're all right.
Okay, this one has, it looks like one of the other frames I had, but it has pollen in it. You see areas that aren't liquid in the middle of the frame are pollen, bright yellow. And certain times they're actually, the way they are there, they've made it into bee bread. So they take pollen and layer it in layers, add a little nectar to it, and it ferments. And it makes this bread. Yeah, and they are basically they're like the detritus feeder, and what they're like the decomposer. They don't kill the colony, but they will go in and eat up all your good comb after mites do, or something else. So what we try to do is keep good strong colonies of bees to keep the wax moth out. They usually don't go into colonies unless they're weak. Boy, they got that one stuck down. Like so I need a hand grenade.
What you do is find them actually into the hive. You actually just pull that section out then and try to control it that way.
Yeah, or I try to compress the bees so they're not spread apart so much so they can defend their hive. It's a sign, though, that you better look for other things because mm-hmm. something else may be going on. But usually wax moth aren't the cause of the death of a colony ever. I mean, they're not. All right, you're producing drones. That's good. But when you're a queen finder, unless she's marked, it makes it a little harder because what you do is put a mental image in your head of queen with a big fat abdomen, and then you can go with your eyes real fast. But when you got a bunch of competing drones, it's a little bit harder to spot her, but I haven't seen her yet. This one's probably marked, isn't she, Michael?
I'm not sure.
Okay, well, if she isn't, we'll mark her. We see her.
Keeping is new for this year. These, we, the town of
projects right before this, and this is payback.
Well, this was a self-assigned one. Get myself in the thing.
I know. I've had you open a little bit now, haven't I? Yeah, I know. You want to tickle my fingers, don't you? Finger massage. Well, she's been here recently. Full of eggs. See new bees, they look out, they look a little, almost like a newborn fawn. Their hairs are kind of matted down, and they have a ring of long hairs around their edge of their compound eyes that disappears as they get a little older. I thought she was going to be here. There she is. She is here. She's not marked. You want to mark? You have see if you got the paint. A little marker. I got to get the propolis off my fingers so I can grab her without sticking everything together. Yeah, I'll show you what she is.
Now, will they put a lot of time and energy back into putting the propolis back in after you?
Yeah.
Yeah. I like it all sealed up.
Yeah, what you have to do is, that's why you don't go in your beehive every day.
Right.
Mm-hmm. You go into it when you need to and only when you need to. Mm-hmm. But at this time of year, you'd need to go into every about 7 to 10 days to take off swarm cells. Because if you do not, and I made a mistake, because while you're trying to mark queens, you concentrate on the queen and you don't talk.
Okay. Because you lost her.
Because I lost her. But I found her again, so now I'm going to shut up. Thank you very much.
Michael's not going too far in there.
I'm not getting in there.
I guess no, all you need to do is hand me the thing, Bob.
Okay.
All right, Her Majesty is in my, by the wings is here. Take my finger and I put it down like so. And she's got 6 legs, so I try to get 3 of them on one side at least, like that. Sorry, smoker is a bit smoky. Whoa, I got her really good. She's gonna have sidewalls too, I think. This is what the queen looks like. Let me get the smoker down here out of the way. Let me show you what she looks like. Yeah, but too big of a drop, so I got her real good. I didn't get her ocelli, just got her wings.
Oh, wow.
I overmarked her.
Yeah.
I overmarked her, but that's cool because now we're going to see her from 10 feet away. Normally just put the dot on this. The paint was a little bit lumpy. It's okay. We didn't get the ocelli or the head, which is I would be more worried about. And I'm not touching her abdomen. If I showed you real close, there's an egg hanging out.
Wow. She's a busy. What are you going to do with her in there?
Well, I'm just going to put her in here and let her chill. Yeah, I know. That's what my hand's good for. So any other questions while I'm letting this queen dry?
Because the other bees will eat the paint off, right?
Yeah. We found out that started to be the case when we painted them and looked at them close, and sometimes they wouldn't touch them. And other times they go in, they eat the paint off. I mean, it's a foreign thing. Hey, you messed my queen. You put shellac on her. I've got to get it off of her.
It says marks on anything.
Boy, I tell you, that was a... I never given a queen that much paint yet. That's one heck of a green dot. I think she's stuck to the sidewall in here with it. She's going to be entirely... She's an Irish bee. I'm sorry, Hunt, my darling.
Do you have to put her back on the same super that you...
No.
Tray that you...
I got so much paint on her, it's going to take her 2 weeks to dry. I'm going to put her back. Come on, girl.
Paint dry to the side.
That's right. I told you. We really got her painted that time. We shouldn't be able to have problems finding her.
Yeah, sometimes you do. So you have to be careful. You have to see if you can brush
it. Should we be using orange paint again?
I could.
It's all coordinated.
Yeah, so you can tell how old it
is. Yeah, you're gonna tell them. You got a mnemonic that's cleaner than the one I use?
I don't know.
Okay, I can't tell them mine.
Especially on video.
That's right. Okay, let's see. It's zero. It starts with zero. Okay, this is 10. Yeah, it is blue. Blue this year. It'll be yellow next year. Red the following year, and then green. Whoops, I messed up. I'm gonna put this one outside. You hear that when I made that? Bees went, and what are you doing with me? You're moving too fast. Banging around. Not with these. I mean, these aren't, we're not really trying to make honey production. If we make some, that's fine. But these are primarily drone, for drone production. And so we're not getting, I don't really want to have the excluder in there as to exclude the bees. Smoke's good for getting bees to move out of the way, so you won't squash them and they won't get as excited. If you add too much, they'll fly. And if you put too much on, I would have never found that queen. She would have been running all around with the rest of the bees, and there's only one of her and thousands of workers. All right, now bees, put some great honey in that orange super. Go for it. give us some volunteer honey. Yeah, probably about 5 minutes. We're gonna move it out to put it back where it was, make him happy. Mm-hmm. I like these straps a whole lot better than trying to hammer in staples and other stuff into the bee. Before that, you had this Machiavellian staple that was about like this, that you put, you'd hammered two or three in each one. Oh, the bees like that. Ooh, did they like that? They didn't like the beekeeper doing that. Okay, and then what I'll do is I'll put this entrance on. And since we're nearby, these bees here will just take the bag off and they'll fly back over to their new home. I don't think any of them are really interested in coming back in now. Okay, that's about all I've got to show you today. Any more questions?